So as he said, I woke up half hour ago being told I'm doing this talk. So the last time I looked at, this is my slide deck for TechEd 2012. So I did a talk last year, which was on a very, very similar topic, which was on XAML binding view models. Now, the last time I looked at this was at TechEd last year, so it's been 12 months since I've looked at my own code demos. So I don't know how many of you can remember any code you wrote 12 months ago, so hopefully you guys will just forgive me if I stuff up here and there. Now, I'm going to close Skype because I'm sure someone's going to quit Skype. I don't have any other instant messaging stuff open. Nope. Pro tip for everyone, Windows X, you hit Mobility Center, and you hit Presentation Mode. So lots of applications respect that, so things like Skype, MSN, etc. Once you hit that, they shut up. So you won't get all the pop-ups. Okay, so a little bit about me. I work for Infragistics. I'm the regional technical evangelist for them. Infragistics is a company that does UI components, so grids, charts, things like that across Windows 8, Windows Phone, iPhone, Android, etc. A little bit more about me. So you can tell this is my slide deck from last year. So I last year I released a book on Silverlight 5. Yeah, I'll hide my shame. Okay, now, so originally, so you're all here because of the title of the presentation, which was how to do cross-platform development. So how to do it between Windows 8 and Windows Phone 8. Now, what Coetzee was probably going to speak on was the different techniques that you can use to go about actually implementing this in code. So what we're going to do today is have a look at how we can write one common code base which you can run on Windows 8 and Windows Phone 8. There are a bunch of different ways that you can do it. The way that I'm going to be doing it today is with a pattern called MVVM, which stands for Model View View Model. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to take you off from the very, very basics, from first principles, how you would go about this. So I can see quite a few people in the room who are MVVM experts, so a lot of them are going to be smiling and nodding. So I'm going to take you from first principles. So why are we using things like iNotify property change, how we go about setting these things up, how we can use portable class libraries. So anyone who's new to this sort of stuff, you'll be able to pick it up. So the agenda was based around this. So I'll take you through data binding first and why it's a good thing and how by using that we'll be able to get this cross-platform between Windows 8 and Windows Phone 8. Look at view models, how we actually build them up to do this sort of pattern. iNotify property change, observable collections, data templates to make things look sexy, commands, PCL. Caliban Micro, I'm going to skip because I haven't had a chance to install that framework on at all, and I can't remember how to do the bootstrap for it. So we'll probably have to skip off that last bit. So I started for my first demo, updating the UI manually. Now, the good thing is, at the end of last year, after my TechEd talk, I actually, where are we? Demos. TechEd. So what I did after my session last year was my video got released, and so I watched my video, then I went back over my code, and then I actually did a git check-in at different timestamps. So if you have a look at all of the check-ins that I've got one at each timestamp, like 5 minutes, 10 minutes, 15 minutes, so you could work through the code while you're watching my video last year. So what's really good about that is if I stuff up, I can look at my own code from last year, so we should be okay. Okay, so for my first demo, I'm going to go about how you may go about updating the UI manually. So anyone who was doing Windows Forms development, it was a while ago, but in my job, what I do, I see quite a lot of people still using Windows Forms. So we'll go over how you may have gone about updating the UI manually. So we'll look at it, then we'll have a look at the reasons why doing it that way is bad, so then we know why we're going to be doing it a different way. So I'm going to go C# Windows Store blank app demos. Please work demo 1. Okay, so this is the default one. So show of hands, how many people have done a file new project on a Windows 8 application so far? bit less than half the room? Okay. That's fine. For anyone who hasn't, there we go. It looks pretty much exactly the same as any other .NET desktop app project. So Windows 8, WPF, Silverlight, they all kind of look like that. So with the only thing that we've got in here at the moment, because it's a blank one, let's close that, we've got mainpage.xaml. Okay, very first thing that I'm going to do is wait for it to load up. There we go. I'm going to put in a stack panel. So for me, stack panel is the number one control in the entire framework. That font's small, I'm going to scroll it for you. Big enough yet? Okay. Yeah, stack panel. Every single one of my applications, all of my UIs are done via stack panels. It makes everything just line up nicely. Otherwise, you're forever trying to move pixels up one, down one. So what we're going to do here, we're going to do two things. We're going to add a button. We're going to call it my button. And we're going to have its contents sent to... No, we're not. We're leaving it like that. Then we're going to add a text block. So two different ones. A text box is something you can type into. A text block is a label. And let's give it that a name of our text block. Cool. Now, because my resolution is so high, we need to go font size, crank that up to about 24. Give it some text. There we go. Thanks. Font size, 72. There we go. Okay, so far all we've got on our UI is a button and a text block. So what a lot of people probably do is on the text block, on the button, I'm going to double click that. And that seems to be a new feature I only just discovered. If you have a XAML control, if you click in it, you can update it. I don't know when that came about. Undo. Anyway, if I double click on it, it's going to do the standard wire up a click event. So a lot of this, when we get started, probably do it that way. So when we click that button, we're going to do text block.text equals hello world. Hit F5, it'll compile. We hit click me, hello world. So I'm sure lots of us have done that. We've found that UI element and we've gone and updated it manually. Now, when we get started, doing that way is fine, but unfortunately, when we have a look at the MBVM framework, what we're gonna be seeing there is it's very easy to, you can change your UI and then suddenly your code doesn't compile at all. Now, doing it like that, text block.text, so it may work on that, but if we change that to something like a radio button or a checkbox, so we're going to be referencing each of those controls individually, and we're going to be referencing individual properties on that control, which means we can't just chop and change UI controls around. So on the text block, it was called text, but on the button, the label was actually a property called content. So if you do try and change it from a button to a text block, for example, as soon as you do that, your code's not going to compile because you're referencing properties on a control. So we don't like doing things with controls directly. So what we're going to do instead is close that. What we're going to do next is title the couple to the view. That's bad. Delete the text block. Yeah, cool. There we go. So rather than referencing those controls individually, what we're going to do is use the model view, view model pattern. So then we can just have a state, and then all of our UI controls are going to have a look at our state, which is held in the view model. So I'll go through and show you the code how to do that. Then we'll go back to the slide, and I'll explain it a little bit better. So we go back to this. We're going to delete the text block, button logic. Yep, sorry, it's refreshing my memory, it's been 12 months. Okay, button can go. My click event can stay there. So I'm going to create two folders now. Add new folder. I'm going to have a folder for views. We're going to have a folder for view models. So we're going to create a brand new class. We're going to call it main page view model. Hit OK. So view models are just a plain standard class. And the view models are going to hold the state for what your screen should be showing. So your view model is going to be holding things like any data that's downloaded from a web service, the current state of text that is in buttons, things like that. So this one class is going to hold the state for the entire screen. Our UI is going to be extremely dumb. It's not going to know anything. It's just going to be data bind. Oh, my water. It's going to just data bind directly to this class. So let's make this public, because I can't hear the amount of times I've forgotten to set that public, and then I'm swearing at it for quite a while. So we're going to add a new property. Pro tip for anyone who hasn't seen it. You can't see it because I haven't scrolled in. So if you type in prop for property, hit tab, it'll actually do an auto property for you. So you can type in string, hit tab, greeting, bam. So we've got an auto property there. View model, view text block, then bind it. Okay, that's fine. So at the moment, the state of our screen is just a single property called greeting, so we were able to update that to put whatever text we want in there. So if we go back to the XAML, so our text block now, we can say the text equals. So there's a format to say how you go about binding. So you put in the curly braces, you type in binding, and then you can type in the name of the property that you want to bind it to. So in that case, that was called greeting. So now this text block knows to bind to that data and just show it there. But we haven't told this view, this screen yet, where it should be getting that data from. Now, there are lots of ways to wire up the view model with this screen, but the easiest way, if I go page.dataContext, so this is what you do for demos when you're doing real code. Don't do it this way. So for the data context of this page, we're going to say it should be local. Let's compile first. Need to tell it the namespace that it's in. So I'm going to bring in the namespace, so XML namespace. I'm going to call it view models, and that's going to equal IntelliSense. There we go. Please work demo one. There we go. Okay, so in the data context now I can reference view models, and we've only got one there, main page view model. Let's just clean that up a bit. There we go. So we've given this page our view model now, so now we can start data binding. So let's just go into our view model. I'm just going to CTOR, constructor, weird, and hit tab, it'll bring it up. So we're just going to go greeting equals hello world from view model. So if everything works well, we should see, there we go. So there wasn't that much code to get that working. We created a new blank class, we added a single property to it, and then we just changed our view so it knows to data bind to our view model. So just by doing those few little things, now we've made our UI a bit more flexible. So we can go and change it from being a text block that is displaying this to maybe a text box, or maybe an Infogistics awesome control, something like that. So that's step one. But now we're just reading things from the view model at the moment. What we want to do is do things on the screen and have that update the view model, so then the screen is going to update itself. So let's go back. Okay, so the question was, am I going to show how you can set the view model in a real app? It depends is the crappy answer. Once you get into this a little bit more, so I'm going to be showing how you can do everything by hand. so you can do it this way. And once you start getting into it a little bit more seriously, you're more than likely going to be using an MVVM framework to help you out with this. So something like MVVM Lite or Caliburn Micro. And so with those ones, they usually have a little bit of magic where you just, in app.startup, you put in a little bit of code so we can you point it at where all your view models live. You can find all your view models. And so by doing the pattern of having the view and the view model have the same name, so customer's view, customer's view model, it automatically wire them up for you. So that's one way of doing it. Another way is by using a locator pattern. So you do a little bit of inversion of control. So you can set that up. You just, again, point it at where all of your view models are. So then in your view, you can set the data context rather than hardwiring that view model in there. You can just do a static resource, point to your locator class that can new up the view model that it needs. Okay, let's go back to our view. So at the moment, we're just doing read-only. So let's add in another button. Content equals add one. So what we're going to do now is, rather than text, we're going to make this a business app, and we're going to have widgets. So whenever we click on a button, we're going to add a new widget. So to do that, we're going to have a new text block. Get rid of that. So we're going to bind to something called total. So we're going to have the total number of widgets that we've made so far. So we're just going to display that. Then whenever we click this button, we're going to add one more widget to this. So same thing, let's double click that. Let's go back to our view model and let's add that new property. So we go prop tab int tab total for our total number of widgets. So that's going to, because it's an int, that's just going to default to zero. So actually if I go back to our UI now, go back to the XAML, do a recompile. There we go. So we're already getting design time data now. So because we've wired all of this up to just do data binding to a view model, we haven't done anything, but our UI is showing this. So I could change the default values and it'll come up. So this is a good way to have some design time values, a very